Good morning, church family. I'm so glad that you're here for worship this morning. My name is Alex Rose, and I'm the next-gen minister here at the Church at Avenue South. If you're a first-time guest with us this morning, welcome. We are so glad you're here with us. Please stop by the welcome desk in the lobby before leaving to find out how you can get connected to our church. For our members and those of you who have been worshiping with us for some time, you know that our campus and teaching pastor, Aaron Bryant, has been on sabbatical for the last 5 weeks, dusting for God's fingerprints and resting and communing with the Lord, to be first a son of the Most High and second the leader of our campus. This morning, I'm out of town with my family, but I want to invite you to take a front row seat in welcoming Aaron Bryant back this morning. As you know, Aaron is a phenomenal teacher, shepherd, and pastor, but he's also a space enthusiast, a former Tennessee Titan, and a lover of film scores. He loves our congregation, his staff, and most of all, his wife, Amy, and their three children, Silas, Isaiah, and Ellis Joy. He's my pastor, boss, coach, friend, and brother. Aaron, as you know, it's a beautiful but a broken world. Welcome back. We can't wait to hear you preach the word this morning.
Oh my gosh. It's so humbling. I did not know Alex was going to record that, and so I'm incredibly grateful for that. Hey, listen, it is so good to be back, and I love you, and I have missed you. I've been grateful for the time away, and so I do want to say this. For the last 4 weeks, five Sundays, our church believes, the leadership of the church believes, that if we'll take care of our souls, then that has a trickle-down effect to the staff and then to the congregation. And so I'm very grateful that the leadership every 5 years not only encourages us, but makes us take a sabbatical. But I'm aware not everybody can do that. Maybe it's your place of employment. You can't take a month to do that. So I want to tell you that I realize how unique and how blessed I am. I also want to express my gratitude that you've allowed me to do that as a congregation, the leadership of the church, and then our staff. Even today, big shoes to step into. I mean, last week, Todd Bishop, Nick Gonzalez, many others who've preached in my absence. I'm grateful to the staff, to these men, to you as a congregation. So please receive my gratitude and my love. I love you. I've missed you. And I'm so grateful to be back with you again this morning. Hey, in this moment, every Sunday morning, whether it's pastor coming off sabbatical or whatever it may be, we always worship through singing, through praying together, and also reading God's word together. So it would be highly unusual if I didn't, like right now in this moment, say, hey, open up your Bibles to John chapter 20. If you have a copy of the scriptures, open up your Bible to John chapter 20 as we dig into his word for us today. And while you're doing that, let me share with you briefly. When you're on sabbatical, I do pray for you. I pray for us. I pray for vision for the future. I believe 2025 is going to be an incredible year for us. So I will share more about that later. But I put this picture on the screen to let you know that I'm a driven person. I'm an achiever. Sometimes strength's out of control. Being an overachiever can be a weakness. You're driven to do well. I want to honor the Lord. I want to honor you. I want our church to be healthy and growing in all the ways biblically it should. And so when you're forced to stop achieving, stop running wide open, and sit and be with the Lord, you kind of got to get there, right? And it was so wonderful this trip to go out west. I've shared with you before. I hear from the Lord kind of out west in the American Southwest. This is a picture about an hour north of Santa Fe, right outside of a town called Abiquiu. For whatever reason, the last 10 to 12 years, I've been able to go out there, see one of my mentors, stay at his home. Then from that kind of base camp, hike and travel. And so I drove onto this familiar property where I took this picture here. And I was just, it was 48 hours into sabbatical. I was thrilled to be there, so excited. And when I pulled onto the property, I just got out of the car and just smelled the air and soaked it in. And the painted rocks and the sun's, you know, just shining through the clouds and all of this. And so I just snapped a picture real quick and I sent it to Amy. And I said, you know, the only thing missing out here, and she responded, is me. And I said, that's right. And I sent it to her, and I was thrilled to be there, and I was going to be with the Lord, but in your flesh, and so many times we can be running wide open, even right now this morning, that it's a natural tendency to stay plugged in and to stay focused on the relationships here horizontally with other humans. And so I just, you know, I closed my phone up, set it on the console, and was about to start driving again. And I said, a picture won't do it justice. You ever been on vacation and you send a picture and you're like, and I don't even describe it, right? You want to share it with somebody that you love and care about that can appreciate it. And I said out loud, oh, but this picture doesn't even do it justice. I wish she were here. And immediately the Lord said to me, why can't it just be us? Why can't it just be us? And I don't hear audible voices, so it wasn't like this booming, loud voice. It was in the stillness. Best way I know to describe, in the stillness of my heart, I heard it so audibly clear that the Lord, and I do spend time with him where it's just us. And I just pray to him, and I turn off my phone, and I'm not with my family. I'm not with anybody else. I do that regularly. But he just reminded me, like, this whole time is just for us to be together. I don't want you to accomplish. I don't want you to achieve. Scripture says, be still and know that I am God. And so I just sat right here where I snapped this picture. There's no filter on this picture. I just began to sit and rest in the presence of God's beautiful creation and all of his glory, and just to abide with him, which is what he wants most for us and with us. And I just want to encourage you, I'm grateful that leaders lovingly forced me to take a sabbatical. If you can't do that, whether it's, you know, 24 hours, turning your phone off, not picking it up, you know, abstaining from social media or Netflix or whatever it may be, no one will prioritize that for you if you don't do it for yourself. But I am so grateful that as the Lord abided with me, he filled my cup so that out of the overflow of my time with him, I can then minister and serve and accomplish and be with people. And you need that. Whatever you got to do, make it happen. And so I'm so grateful that I've heard the sound of his voice, and I just want to thank you for that opportunity. And I just want to share with you where I've been. I traveled a little bit, stayed here in town a little bit off the grid, and so I'll talk more about that in the weeks ahead. But again, thank you so much for giving me that opportunity, and I just want to encourage you to prioritize abiding and being with the Lord. And if that's all you accomplish, just being with him, that's the best thing you can do for your relationship with him. Now listen, I told you to open up to John chapter 20, so I'm not going to talk all about my sabbatical. Listen, as much as hopefully that's helpful to you, God's word is authoritative and trustworthy, and anything that the Lord says through his word is more helpful and beneficial for you than any pastor in America can share with you. And so what we're going to do this morning from John chapter 20 is we're going to read several verses together, and we're going to talk about how God's word can impact and change our lives, even this very moment. If you have your Bibles open to John chapter 20, as is our tradition here at the church, would you stand in honor of God's word? I'm going to put these verses on the screen. We're just going to read verses 1 through 10 together, but we stand to acknowledge God's presence here and say, we just want to be with you. Would you speak to us because we're listening? So let's start in verse 1. On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, and while it was still dark, she saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she went running to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." At that, Peter and the other disciple went out heading for the tomb. And the two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and got to the tomb first. Stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then following him, Simon Peter also came. He entered the tomb and saw the linen cloths lying there. The wrapping that had been on Jesus' head was not lying with the linen cloths, but was folded up in a separate place by itself. And the other disciple who had reached the tomb first then also went in, saw, and believed. For they did not yet understand the scripture that Jesus must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to the place where they were staying. Let's pause right there for a moment, and I will say the word of the Lord if you would say thanks be to God. The word of the Lord. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your word that is authoritative. It has influence in our life. It is trustworthy. It changes lives, and we profess our belief in that to you in this moment. I'm also praying and asking that your word would work in the soil of our heart over the next few moments. Convict, challenge, exhort, encourage, comfort, whatever it may be that every woman, man, teenager, or child needs to experience from the sound of your voice and your authoritative word, we pray that you would do it in a way that as a church, we are formed and shaped to look more like Jesus, and we're different when we leave here in just a moment than we were when we walked in. And Lord, as we're going to see in the scripture, I pray that for each of us individually, when we leave here, we would do something. We would live as if the truth that we have just encountered matters in our daily lives. Lord, do it for your glory and the joy of your church. And we pray this in Jesus' name. And all of God's people said, amen. Go ahead and have a seat for the next few minutes. If you've been with us for any length of time, you know I encourage you to keep your Bibles open as we kind of chew on this passage for just a moment. So please do that with me. We read in verse 1 that on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene, who was a follower of Jesus, who had had a difficult and sordid past before she encountered Jesus, she's one of the followers of Jesus who ran to the tomb on the resurrection morning to finish up the burial preparations for Jesus. You may remember that the day in Hebrew culture began at sundown. So Jesus was crucified on a Friday afternoon, and they hurried to anoint, wrap, and get his body into the borrowed tomb where they were going to lay him, because they knew that at sundown for the Sabbath, they weren't supposed to do any work. That's something God had commanded his people long ago in Scripture. We saw that when we walked through the Old Testament earlier this year. Think about that for a moment. God wanted the day to begin at sundown and that they would rest. You can't do anything. They didn't have electricity. You would rest when the day began. And then in the morning when you woke up, half the day is left, you would work and achieve out of the overflow of your restfulness. That's a good word for us as well. So they hurried to get Jesus down into the tomb on Friday because the Sabbath, the 24-hour period from sundown on Friday to sundown on Saturday was beginning. They couldn't work. So this was the first moment that anybody who followed Jesus, loved Jesus, and believed that Jesus was still in that tomb could go finish up like with dignity and respect, properly wrapping and anointing the body. So Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark. Verse 1 tells us she saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. Matthew's gospel tells us that there was an earthquake that shook the earth and that there was an angel that had rolled the stone away. Each of the gospel writers capture what they remember, what the Holy Spirit wanted them to tell their audience. It would be just like if we're in one spot and Isaiah and Ben and Eddie and myself, four guys, were standing there and we saw the same thing. We're going to describe it probably in different ways. And if I'm speaking to Romans, I'd say it one way. If you're speaking to a Jewish culture, you'd say it another way so that they could understand it. So each of the gospel writers captured different aspects. So we don't fully understand everything that Mary would have walked up on, but the stone has been rolled away. She's going to see Jesus because she believes Jesus is in the tomb. The stone is gone, so she immediately probably starts to panic. If the stone's gone, that means anyone can get in and out of, like, and so what does Scripture tells us? So verse 2, so she went running to Simon Peter and to the other disciple, the one that Jesus loved. And this is John, the disciple, who says the one that Jesus loved. This isn't like a humble brag. I don't know if you've ever done that, like you kind of drop in a story, something you've accomplished without really referring to your name. But John is saying, like, she ran to Peter and the one that Jesus loved, which was him. Within the 12 disciples, there was a smaller group of three, Peter, James, and John, that Jesus was closer with. And even then further still, there was John, the beloved disciple that he was closest to within those three. So Peter, or John, is humbly saying, she came to Peter, she came to me, and she said to them, they've taken the Lord. He's not in there. Like someone stole the body. Verse 3, at that, Peter and the other disciple went running to the tomb. Now, if John wasn't bragging earlier, here's where you might see a little bit of a humble brag among the disciples. John tells it this way, the two were running, but the other disciple, that's me, outran Peter, and he got to the tomb first. Now listen, Peter was probably older than many of the other disciples, but some of the disciples, we truly believe, were in their later teenage years. Have you ever, I've been a youth minister, have you ever worked with teenage boys? And they love competing over anything, right? You know that they loved talking about who got to the tomb faster. And John says, we both started out running, and I got there first. And when I got there, verse 5, stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying there. But John says, but I did not go in. When presented with like really like incredible realities, like the tomb is empty, the stone is rolled away, it's a lot to process. And I just want you to hear, these are the disciples who were with Jesus for 36 plus months in his public ministry. And John most likely is like, wow, it's empty. Like, see, even devout followers of Jesus, even people in this room have questions, have to have time to process things, can't explain or understand everything God's doing. So John stood there and didn't go in. But it says, verse 6, Simon Peter also came and he entered the tomb and he saw the linen cloths lying there. And it says in verse 7, the wrapping that had been on Jesus' head was not lying with the linen clothes, but was folded up in a separate place by itself. This is not the sermon to share all the historical and evidential facts to prove to you that the resurrection actually happened. It did. And there are no throwaway lines in scripture. And so when John says, like, there are, like, the cloths around him were over here, and, like, the cloths that were around his head were folded and over here, is further evidence, like, if you were going to steal the body, if you truly were going to steal the body, and it's heavily guarded, even if the soldiers fell asleep and they might wake up if you're rustling around and moving a multi-ton stone, as if you could, like, you wouldn't take time to be like, oh, here we are, we're grave robbers. Before we take the body, like, take the burial clothes off, fold them nice and neat, put a little mint on the pillow over here, and here's what we're going to do over here. Like, you wouldn't do that. You'd run in. You'd grab the body, all of it, clothes, body, everything, and you'd run. And what John is telling you is, like, it happened, and it wasn't stolen. Like, Jesus even had time when he left the tomb, like, to fold or to set this here. Like, it was, as I'm describing it to you, the wrapping that had been on his head was not lying there. It was folded up separate. Like, the resurrection of Jesus happened. Verse 8, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first, this is John, then also went in, saw the evidence of the resurrection, and it says, and he believed. And he believed. The word here for believe is like accepting something as reality. Like, I trust what I am seeing and experiencing, like, but I don't fully understand it. It's accepting without fully being able to explain what has happened. You know, Hebrews 11:1 says that faith is the evidence or the assurance. It's having confidence in what we hope for. Jesus had said over and over and over again in his public ministry, the Son of Man must be betrayed. He was sinless. He was perfect. Jesus is God in the flesh. And so Jesus said, I have to lay down my life, and in my perfect life, I'll absorb your punishment for sin, and I'll shed my perfect blood to pay for your sin. So, like, it has to happen. There's no way for you to go to heaven. There's no way for you to have eternal life. You can have eternal death, but you can't have eternal life unless I am crucified on the cross, and that's going to happen. But Jesus didn't just die for his followers. Jesus was also raised to new life for his followers. And he told them, 3 days after I'm placed in a borrowed tomb, I will be resurrected. John can't explain how all that happens. You and I can't explain how it all happens. But John says, Jesus promised, and Paul told the church in Corinth, that all the promises of God find their yes in Jesus. Meaning all the promises of God that he's ever made are validated in the finished work of Jesus Christ, his death on the cross and his resurrection from death. And so John says, I accept. I believe this is exactly what he said was going to happen. John doesn't believe because Jesus is there. John believes because Jesus isn't there. The tomb is empty, and so he knows the throne in heaven is occupied, and he believes. And I want to share this to anybody in the room that you've heard sermons, you've been to church, you got questions, you're exploring the claims of Christ. At some point,
You either go all in or you don't. And there's some of us that are like, I still got questions. I still don't understand everything. Listen, faith is the evidence or the assurance of what we hope for and what God tells us and we put our faith in. And when you die and go to be with Jesus, or if we're still alive when he comes back, you'll see him with your eyes and you won't have to have faith because your faith will be made sight and it will be absolutely incredible. And it's okay if you got questions. It's okay if you can't explain it all. John couldn't, but he says, I believe. And so sooner or later, somebody in this room, you're going to have to step out in faith and you're going to have to believe even with questions. Faith is having questions and still trusting Jesus. Faith is being scared and still trusting Jesus. And so John says, I believe. And verse 10 says, then the disciples returned to the place where they were staying. I just have serious problems with that. They arrive at the tomb. The body of Jesus is not there because God has rolled away the stone and raised him from the dead. And when God raised Jesus from the dead, that is God saying, well done, son. It is finished. It's what Jesus said on the cross. Everything you've done has made it possible for anybody to be forgiven by the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ. Like, well done, son. The resurrection validates everything Jesus accomplished on the cross, and it gave Jesus victory over death. Which means when you place your faith in Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit takes up residence in your life, the Holy Spirit will never leave you or forsake you. He is the presence of the risen Jesus. You can't lose your salvation. You can sin and do silly or stupid things that make you feel shame or embarrassment or distance from God, but you can't lose your salvation. And when the Holy Spirit takes up residence, whether it's 2 weeks, 2 months, 2 decades, whatever it may be, when you do finally close your eyes in eternal rest through death, you'll be ushered into the presence of God and he will say, I recognize myself in you. You belong to me. It is a deposit guaranteeing what is to come. Like, that is what is happening. That's what's being made possible through the resurrection. You don't show up, Jesus is alive, life-changing moment and say, Let's go back to the house and see what's on Netflix. Let's go back and see what's for dinner. Like verse 10 says, they just went back to where they were staying. And I'm like, no. Like, if that happened, you got to go tell somebody. I talked to somebody this morning that was so excited when they were sharing like a couple of their favorite things for the weekend. They were like, and my football team, and they named their football team. My football team won. Like, that's who we are as people. We love sharing what arrests our attention and makes us feel good and that we enjoy doing, right? Like, you got to go tell somebody that. And so they went back. And listen, I've probably been hard on John and Peter. Like, I can't believe you didn't tell anybody about that. But how many of us in just a moment when we leave here won't tell anybody about what Jesus has done for us the next 6 days until we come back in this room? How many of us, let's just say, like, if you're a parent and God's teaching you something, how many of us won't tell our kids, like, I'm trusting God with my finances, or I'm trusting God with my relationships, or I'm working through conflict with a friend, and the Lord says to honor them in this way, and it's hard, but I'm trusting him in this. Like, tease it out. Sharing the gospel with your coworker, talking to your children, your loved one, whatever it may be. How many of us will leave here and nothing will change, right? That's why that sign's on the wall to your right and my left, the number 1 over 168. I've never really been good with math, okay? So that's a pretty big fraction there, but we meet for an hour on Sunday morning, give or take a few minutes. There's 168 hours in the week, and if you are actually going to see the good news, the resurrection of Jesus, transform your life, it's probably going to happen in those other 167 hours. So what are you going to do when you leave here in just a moment? Meant enough to me to put a little cardboard sign up in our old building to remind us, do something with what you're hearing. This is too good not to share with others. And that's why I'm so glad that we haven't finished the story of Mary Magdalene. But verse 11, look with me, verse 11. But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. John and Peter left, but Mary's like, I need a moment. I love Jesus. Jesus healed her. some very difficult things that were going on in her life. She had followed him, and so she stood outside the tomb because she believed somebody stole his body. And as she was crying, she stooped to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where Jesus' body had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. And they said to her, "Why are you crying?" And she says, "Because they've taken my Lord away," in verse 13, and I don't know where they put him. Like, she truly believed Jesus' body was going to be in that tomb. She struggled to believe. That's okay. I told you, you can have questions. You can have doubts. I don't know where they've put him. And so, having said this, verse 14, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. Now, I want you to think about that. Do you ever do this with a text? Like, if you're reading, if you're a student and you read, like, in your dorm room or in the little area where you maybe share with your suite mates, or an apartment or a home, if you own a home, what you should do is you should, I mean, this isn't crazy, but you should kind of, like, live it out a little bit. Like, if you stand in your living room and you're like, "I don't know where they've put him." And there's Jesus. That's different than just, "And there was Jesus standing behind her." There's Jesus. And she sees him, but she doesn't recognize him. And we're going to cut her some slack. If you've ever been through anything traumatic, if you've lost a loved one, it says she showed up crying. She's grieved at true, legitimate loss. She's crying because she thinks somebody stole her rabbi. And she doesn't recognize Jesus. Verse 15, it says, "Woman," and this is the second time she's been called woman, and that is not disrespectful. That's like acknowledging her. "Woman," Jesus said to her, "why are you crying?" I absolutely love this. And Jesus still does this today. He is interested in the source of what's stirring up your emotions in your life. Where's this coming from? What's going on? Now, we know she's crying because she thinks Jesus has been stolen, and she's sad about that. Like, why are you crying? Jesus cares about every little minute detail in your life. Today, he does. What's the source of this sadness? So he validates how she feels. And you need to know that the Lord doesn't lose sight of any of his sheep. Whatever you're going through, he sees you. He hasn't lost track of you. He cares about you. And if you're in a good place this morning, like, "I woke up and things are great." In the future, when you go through something, he hadn't forgotten about you, and he cares. We're seeing it here. But notice what he does. He acknowledges her pain, her grief, her emotion. And then, I love this. Because when we're in one of those moments, like, I don't know how to get out of it. If I knew how to get out of it and could fix it, I'd already done it. Jesus takes the focus off of her emotion and puts it on himself. Because the focus of the Bible is not on us. The focus of the good news of Jesus is not what we get out of it. The focus of the Bible is God. The focus of the gospel is Jesus, who is God. And so he says, not only why are you crying, but who is it that you're looking for? And puts the focus on himself. Supposing he was the gardener, she thought, like, the gardener showed up to rake leaves that morning. Supposing he was the gardener, she replied, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I will take him away. I'll go get him." Like, I don't know how Mary was going to haul off the body of Jesus if that were true. But she's like, "I'm desperate here." And Jesus said to her in verse 16, "Mary, Mary." Now, I've preached this text before. I've sat under preachers that have preached this, and I've heard, and I've even preached, like, how important is Jesus knows your name. I shared with you just a few minutes ago, he knows your name. He knows who you are. He knows what you're going through, and I've often preached that. He calls her Mary. The gardener could have called her Mary. Like, there was something about the voice of Jesus that when he called her, she recognized the sound of his voice, and it changed everything. Do you remember me telling you that when I started my sabbatical, I heard the voice of the Lord, and I knew it was him? And there was something that just laid me bare, that he just wanted to spend time with me. And it was so wonderful and so incredible. Like, we hadn't done or accomplished anything, but just to know Jesus is here and he sees me. To know the sound of his voice, he called her Mary, and she recognized the sound of his voice. And she turned to him in verse 16, and in Aramaic, she said, "Rabboni," which means teacher. She had walked in the dust of this rabbi. This was her rabbi. This is her savior, like, Jesus. And understanding the voice of the Lord is so important.
Because I believe Jesus has been calling some of you in this room, and he's calling and he's calling, and it's so important to hear his voice and to respond to it. About 2.5 weeks ago, I was at one of my son's high school football games, and it was crowded. It was at a visitor stadium. It was crowded. There were several thousand people there. I didn't want to sit in the stands. It felt so far from the field, so I went down in the end zone and stood with some dads, and in the end zone, the end zone is 10 yards deep. You're another 10 yards deep. So I'm about 20 yards from the playing field. And my son, who plays offensive line, things were going their way in the game. It was late in the fourth quarter. They're up by a couple touchdowns. And all we could think about as dads was like, this is a really good team you're playing. And so, like, if you're able to win, that would be awesome. You're up. You've got the ball. Don't do anything silly or stupid. And about the time we were all like, yeah, we just need to be cool and just play it out, one of the players got a personal foul. And all we could think about was like, oh my gosh, like you're going to have to punt the ball back to him. Like, don't do that. And one of the dads was like, why are they doing that? And so one of the dads were like, no. And all I could think was like, just be smart, think. And so the team was huddled up on the 50-yard line, which is 70 yards away. And I said, be smart, think. And my big son, who I could pick out 70 yards away, who wasn't even looking at me, turned and said, it wasn't me. And just looked right back at the huddle. And then I felt a little stupid. Like, parents, I'm not the only person who's tried to coach from the stands, okay? But the other dads got so tickled, and one of them was like, dude, there's thousands of people here. He recognized the sound of your voice. Wasn't even looking at me. I'll never forget it. Turned and looked. It wasn't me. And afterwards, I was like, I wasn't yelling at you. I was just, everybody be smart. Good thing they have about 100 dads every Friday night out there. But it wasn't lost on me how powerful the sound of a father's voice is to his child. Stop you in your tracks. Draw you into relationship. He responded. I mean, that's what a voice does. When it calls you by name and you recognize it, the next response is to engage. And he called her Mary, and she recognized the sound of his voice. And Jesus is calling you, some of you, by name. You've never responded in faith. You've never done what John did. You've never accepted and believed, even with all your questions, all your doubts, all your concerns. And he's calling you today. Like, the word lurking isn't right because that sounds like ominous, but like Jesus was hanging around the tomb the whole time. He ain't in it because he's alive. He's hanging around the whole time, and Mary had no clue. He's like, Mary, Mary. And she recognizes Jesus is doing that today. He's hanging around this room. He's hanging around your workplace. He's hanging around your apartment. He's hanging around your college, and he's calling you by name, wanting you to turn around and say, yes, Jesus. Here I am, I finally believe, like, I trust you, like, and for some of us, today's the day where he's inviting you to trust him. And when Mary heard the sound of his voice, just like me 4 weeks ago, like, I just began weeping, like, to know that you've heard the sound of his voice. He knows who I am. He knows where on the map I am. Oh, there's no one like you. I just want to be with you. I want to abide with you. Mary's like, oh, you know my name. You're God. You really are alive. Everything you said in Scripture is true. And the Bible tells us that she turned and grabbed him because verse 17, Jesus says, don't cling to me. As much as I want to hang out with you, and I'm paraphrasing, there's other things to be done right now. We can't dwell in this moment because I haven't ascended to the Father yet. But in verse 17, he says, but go to my brothers and tell them that I'm ascending to my Father and your Father and to my God and your God. Woo! It's not just Jesus' God now. It's your God and my brothers. Like, we are a spiritual family now. Go tell them. And verse 19 says, Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, I've seen the Lord. Belief is accepting even when you can't explain it all. Belief is putting the full weight of your life on the reality that this is true, therefore I've got to do something with this. And the first thing Mary does when Jesus calls her name is she responds to his command. Go tell others, and she runs and tells.
which means she believed. Further evidence that she says, you're the one, you are alive. And think about this. The resurrection demonstrates the transformational power of the good news of Jesus, of the gospel. Jesus literally was dead. He's raised to new life. Mary shows up at the tomb, crying, weeping, despondent, confused. And then after encountering Jesus, responding to the sound of his voice and saying, I believe, she is full of joy and excitement and says, I will do what you asked me to do. I got to go tell somebody. I mean, the transformation in her life from tired or scared, crying, despondent, to joyful, exciting. I want to hug you. I just want to be like, yes, I'll live as if this is true because it is. Do you see the transformation? There's not a person in this room that Jesus won't do that for you too. There's not a person in this sanctuary that Jesus can't do the same life-changing transformation, whatever your circumstances are. You walked in here despondent. He can bring hope, living hope. We're going to sing in just a moment about Jesus, our living hope. He can bring hope. He can bring joy. He can bring confidence and the assurance that I can't do this, but he already has. And he is my living hope. And he'll do that for you today. And when I preach this, some of you may have known, like, he's been calling me. He's been after me. And now this preacher's saying he's calling me. He's after me. I think that's why when Jesus taught parables, he says, he who has ears, let him hear. Because it might be like 100 people are out there on the hillside, 99 of them are looking down, but he says, he can do this for you today. One of them looked up and said, I know that's true. I don't know how it's true, but I know that's true and I want it. And Jesus said, maybe everybody doesn't respond, but for those of you who do, he who has ears, let him hear. You can have it. Today, who has ears, who wants this, it's yours. Jesus changes lives. The power of the resurrection guarantees it. Did it for John, did it for Mary, did it for Peter. We read about that in the New Testament later in the next few weeks. He'll do it for you. Whatever your circumstances are, he can transform that to hope and joy and confidence and assurance. But I'm going to remind you of this. He asked her at some point, quit focusing on what is going on in your life and focus on me. I see it. It's real. It's legit. I'm with you in this. But I need you to acknowledge, accept, and trust me. So you're going to have to do that to experience all the goodness of Christ. But you can have living hope and new life in him. So here's what I'm going to ask the band to do. I'm going to ask the band to come back up to the platform. So you're going to hear a little bit of rustling, a little bit of movement in the room. But I'm also going to ask you to prayerfully consider what God's calling you to do. So it may be helpful over the next few minutes to bow your head and close your eyes if that eliminates distractions in the room. I'm giving you a couple examples of how the Lord is calling the names of the people in Scripture, how he calls our names today. If the Lord has been after you, he's pursuing you, he's calling your name and asking you to trust him for salvation and eternal life, don't delay in that. Trust him. So over the next couple of minutes, you want to say, I want to follow you for the first time, Jesus. I want to trust you. Confess your sin and your need for him and your desire to trust him. And you do that with questions, with trepidation, with the future unknown. Faith is trusting Jesus anyway. If you have a story like John or Mary or like anybody in the room, if we open up these microphones, this church is full of people that are imperfect. I'm one of them. But we have moments where, like, this was my life before Jesus. This is what happened when I met Jesus. This is who I am now. And it's, I mean, one of the most compelling pieces of evidence of the power of the resurrection is what Jesus has done for each of us. If he's done that in your life, you really should tell somebody about that. If your kids don't know your story of gospel transformation, start there. If the person you're dating doesn't know that, if your suite mates don't know that, if your roommates don't know that, like, you have to tell somebody. Glorify God in that. You never know what he'll do, and your story will be incredibly compelling to others because of the power of Jesus in and through it. So right now, you may know somebody you need to share with, and you need to pray for the guts and the boldness and the courage to do that. So maybe that's what you want to pray about. Let me give you about 120 seconds to pray and tell Jesus what it is that you want to do in this moment. And then Nick and the worship team will ask us to stand and sing with joy and assurance and confidence about the living hope that reminds us that the resurrection is true and that Jesus is still hanging around people's lives, changing them for the better even today. So let's pray.